It would seem, welcome back everybody. It would seem that we have a night of crashing. I don't know. I don't even know what's happening right now, but we're back. 5 seconds remaining. It's game number one between Danish Bears and Scary Faces. We're halfway through the draft right now. Does it die every single time we transfer over?
I'm watching to see.
Oh. See, it like goes for a little while and then it'll just beep, stop working. It's like, nah. That ain't me.
I'm done with this shit. I'm over it. It's still there. That's super weird.
It really is. I don't even know. Anyway.
The draft.
They gave away a lot, but they did not ban the Earthshaker. So they got the Leshrac PL on the side of Danish Bears, but they instead banned AM and Ember Spirit, who I don't really feel like Ember Spirit's a solid counter versus PL. I would much rather take away the Earthshaker.
Oh, really?
Yes. I don't feel like the Battle Fury heroes are the be-all, end-all of Phantom Lancer. I feel like Earthshaker is such a stronger natural counter to PL that you should look to ban him first before the Battle Fury goes. And then if you choose like AM or Ember Spear, like I don't really care which one you ban away there, but you definitely, I think, should ban away the Earthshaker.
I prefer the Earthshaker ban over the AM. I think that Sleight of Fist and the escape you get from Remnants is so good against the PL from the Ember that you can't really leave him there. You know, we saw a lot at TF5, the kind of instant response to a Phantom Lancer was a lot of the time Ember Spirit, just the fact that you can slide through the illusions really easily and defend high ground, especially at that timer where you know a lot of teams like to push, which was 35 minutes, kill the second Roshan or something, and actually get up onto high ground. The Ember does a hell of a lot of work there. And you also have a lot more aggressive potential with the Ember than you do with an AM early on. You know, level 8 and 9 is one of Ember's biggest power spikes. When he gets into his like 3-1-4 build or whatever he goes for, he can go and kill people really easily, regardless of who they are.
Lina now for the Danish Bears. So a 4 position Lina for them. 5 seconds remaining. Why did they pick up the Lina? Just a strong support, I guess, that they prefer. It's good versus the Queen of Pain if you can get that Yule Scepter pretty fast. So maybe that's what they're aiming for. A lot of Scary Faces are easily bursted down by the Lina combination.
We're looking at offlane Earthshaker here, right? From Scary Faces, then Bounty Roaming. Lina does decently against the Bounty Hunter. You know, there are kind of few heroes that during the laning phase can kind of stand and fight. But with her attack damage, her attack speed once she gets up to like level 3, if she goes for a Fiery Soul early on, but just the fact that she has at level 1, 5 stuns from Light Strike Array with her base mana pool, she can actually just stop the Bounty Hunter in his tracks with one well-placed sentry and control him pretty damn well early on.
Right.
While Leshrac and PL, they need their farm time. They need to have their laning phase controlled. And that's why Danish Bears, I think, would have liked the Dazzle, which Scary Face has just banned out. And maybe Shadow Demon can work here for them. Lina SD. You've also got the Leshrac Split Earth to follow through onto the disruption as well. But I don't know if that's kind of focusing. Oh, never mind. Shadow Demon's banned out. Ignore me. He was banned out in the second phase.
Oh, yeah.
Never mind.
Oh, yeah. Gotta stop the Shadow Demon Lesh combination.
Completely missed that.
I mean, you just don't expect Shadow Demon be banned away, right? Like, it's very odd to see him banned out, like, because he's so rarely picked. But suppose when you give away Leshrac, you gotta do what you gotta do. Scary Faces looking to pick up their carry now. What works best against Leshrac and a PL? I'm sure Scary Faces, are they just buying time to talk about it, the strategy a little bit? I hope so, because they have to have an amazing... Oh, they're going to go full aggression. Okay. Storm Spirit and Queen of Pain.
Damn.
Plus an Earthshaker. This is a lot of early game.
Wow. And a lot of mobility against the PL and Leshrac as well. The blinks, the ball lightnings. And a great way to come back into the game if they do, you know, falter at the laning phase. Bounty Hunter with the track.
Yeah, it looks like they're just going to go full aggro against Danish Bears and just be like, okay, you picked a Lesh, but we're going to try and abuse it with Bounty Hunter, Queen of Pain, and Storm Spirit. And then your PL's not going to be ready for a while. And we're just going to go run at you
Fire
for a long time.
Another hero, again, that's very good against Bounty Hunter. So Danish Bears are focusing very heavily on their final two picks, the supports that they needed to control the lanes, give Lashrak and PL some farm time, but also to stop the Bounty Hunter. Shadow Wave is going to have a rough time, honestly.
Right.
Actually getting anything done for the initial stages, but you always look at Bounty early on in his sort of infancy, this patch, where we saw people picking him up, and a lot of his potential was early laning domination. Against the Storm Spirit mid, he'd go in, he'd harass the hell out of them, and that's where you get your power from. But nowadays, in the past, you know, well, since TI5, I guess, is probably the best marker to look at, people have not really put so much emphasis on that laning harass from the Bounty. We're seeing a lot more stacked Bounty Hunters with, like, Poor Man Shield, with Observe Wards, things like this. Orb of Venom still occasionally picked up, but you're always looking for level 6. Level 6 is the one thing you really need from that Bounty to get the track up and running. And if you've got Vision for a Queen of Pain and Storm to give them the opportunity to jump forward rather than be defensive with their abilities, Fisher on top of all of that, a long-range initiation tool it is. Danish Bears, they've got a fair few squishy heroes here.
Danish Bears going to start out with a 5-man push into the enemy jungle. See if they can get some wards up and maybe even an early pickoff. They've got double counter wards here. Both Noya and Ryze are holding on to a pair. So they're really looking to shut down the Bounty Hunter and probably block out one or two stacks. Oh, Storm Spirits get spotted, but they didn't have the heroes in range to be able to stop them. So time to just counter, counter, counter.
Scattered to the wind. Rubick Hyde. That's Ramses, isn't it? Ramses 666 on the Storm Spirit down at bot. With a Soul Ring recipe. Rushing straight into that Soul Ring. Now, our Danish Bear's gonna ward up a bunch of camps here. They've got the double ward over in the pull spot. It doesn't look like they're gonna actually sentry up anywhere else. Well, Shadow Away the Bounty Hunter. Shadow Away the
Bounty Hunter. He's gotta be careful. Is the counter ward gonna be placed preemptively here? Has to Joe. He's gotta start going for it, but Scary Faces are gonna be able to get that bounty rune. Now pull him back. Has to Joe in a bit of trouble, but SFZ are not gonna be able to pursue here. But they did get double bounty runes for their trouble. Queen of Pain got one, Storm Spirit got the other. Great start.
Yeah, Deathshaker gets his block up at top. Stopping the ES getting experience here is actually going to be pretty difficult, especially when you're putting the Crystal Maiden mid for a short while at least to stop the bounty coming in and causing havoc for this Leshrac. But look at them. They're just waiting to see. Does the Bounty Hunter show up? Is there a Sentry Rune placed here already? It's a lot of mind games around the Bounty Hunter as well. We see a ton of sentries given to mid laners, them placing it, dewarding each other, and then supports come in as like this secondary wave of sentries actually flying out. But it's always on, like, the onus is always on the people against the Bounty Hunter. There we go. The sentry trade-off. Shadowy, he's got Invis. Should be fine just to get himself away.
He's got that extra regen coming in from eating that sentry, yeah. So he'll actually recover a lot of the HP lost.
But like that right there is just so indicative of the bounty game and the mind games that come around it.
Yeah.
The sentry ward has to be placed by the Crystal Maiden first, and then bounty comes in, sentry wards himself, eats the enemy sentry, and he's won. He has won stage one in that game.
This time around, we're going to have a Clockwork who is going to be much more farmed than last game. We already have level 3 on our Clockwork. Looks like he used that Dire Side block for some easy levels. See where he goes from here. I think he definitely goes for the Rocket builds because you're dealing with two very very mobile intelligence heroes that Battery Assault is not going to be effective against. But oh, and then Rubick, like Battery Assault isn't particularly good against him because of Telekinesis too.
Yeah, your options for aggressive plays on this lane, and even looking, you know, 15 minutes into the future, are pretty limited.
Yeah.
Unless you get the Earthshaker caught up.
Pretty much all game, you have to go Bounty Hunter or Earthshaker.
Yeah.
If you want that kind of guaranteed kill.
So does that also impact your item decisions as well? Because Blade Mail isn't going to be amazing here either.
Yeah, he may still go for it just because Blade Mail's just generally strong. You have a lot of uncontrollable damage, even though, like Storm Spirit, as you said, Queen of Pain.
Oh, Noya, mid lane, one more hit, General.
Oh! Oh, won't be able to get it. Noya gets away thanks to, in part,
RNG.
Yeah. Queen of Pain. Health potions backed up. There's a lot of that. I would say that the Blade Melt, like the Storm Spirit and the Queen of Pain, have this uncontrollable damage, you know?
Scream and Remnant.
Yeah, Scream, okay. Remnant, Sonic Wave.
Even
you
the
may
overload.
Still go for it if you're far enough ahead. And you do, like, you just naturally draw a lot of attention to yourself. I think it was Bulba said, like, he pretty much, he thinks that Blade Melt is essential in the hero. Like, that you can't. Now, I'm not going to fully agree with that, but Bulba's a renowned Clockwork player, so he obviously knows something about what he's talking about.
There's, like, the understated factors about the Blade Mail as well. You know, the armor, the mana regen, the mana pool it gives you.
Yeah.
The actual stats you get from the item itself, regardless of the active. But it kind of makes you not targetable somewhat. People, you know, maybe a little bit scared. They don't want to target you with too much damage. And then it opens up the fight. You can run yourself through and maybe find another target. It's Earthshaker, look at him. Spotted out by the Observer Ward, but they're not going to get the opening onto the last track just yet.
Maybe they'll get Noya now. He's going to be fissured here in a second. Nice block off, and we'll be able to finish him off. General will claim that kill. So he gets the first blood.
Yeah,
good start.
One of the greatest upsides to that Earthshaker offlane is that, fair enough, he might not get a lot of farm. He gets his experience from holding the wave back and trying to disrupt the enemy. But he acts as kind of a third support. He can actually move from the offlane, control top rune, and move towards the middle lane. While heroes like, you know, Clockwork, like Darkseer, they don't have that capability. Unless they get a haste, unless they get an invis rune, something that enables them to do it. Earthshaker just innately can come in with a long-range fissure and set things like that up.
I like the choice to leave the Storm Spirit in lane alone against the Clockwork, though. While they haven't been able to zone him out, it's going to be a dire side Clockwork. It's hard to do anyway. I think it's very important to give the Storm Spirit full experience out of lane. Oh, are they going to get Noya again? Fissure? Yep, they got him.
Oh, man.
This poor Crystal Main goes back to the jungle to try and get some levels there, but he's immediately spotted out by the Bounty Hunter, and the Earthshaker rotates in for good measure.
I really thought that with the Lina Crystal Maiden combo, they'd shut down his Bounty Hunter handsomely, but with the Earthshaker running around helping him out, Shadowy, he's on a roll, and now he's looking for the Leshrac as well. Fisher to block him in.
He's done for, and he knows it too. He just turns around and goes for the stun.
Disastrous laning phase so far. The Phantom Lancer, sure enough, he's farming away like a madman. But does he have the early game impetus that's needed against the Storm and the Queen of Pain? Because it's not just one, you know, we've talked about this time and time again. It's not just one mobile int carry, but it's two. They've got long-range initiation coming out of pretty much everywhere. They can TP to tier ones, they can zip onto you. The Phantom Lance might be able to doppelganger away, but you need camped initiation there to stop it or turn the fight around. Which is then, you know, a domino effect. If the PL needs a good time, you're going to have the Clockwork getting his levels, get to level 6, get his items, so he can TP in and react to these fights. You need the Leshrac to get his items as well. And I'm wondering, does Hester Joe go for Bloodstone here, or do you go for the more aggressive Yules first?
I think you have to go Yules first, just because you know that you're going to be feeling a lot of pressure and the Bloodstone's going to lose a lot of its effectiveness if you're constantly being ganked up by Storm Spirit and Queen of Pain and shut down without getting any kills. So I would much prefer to see the aggressive build. That would also punish the Queen of Pain and Storm Spirit if they choose to go for aggressive builds. Looks like they picked off the Clockwork in the bottom lane. Bounty Hunter is about to pick up his level 4, but 6.5 minutes in, purely through roaming and getting kills, this is
crazy good, honestly.
Yeah.
Well, General, zapped down a little bit by that 4-second cooldown Lightning Storm. But Hester Joe's pushed forward pretty far here. I guess Bounty, not yet level 4, so the 2 points in Shuriken aren't available.
He's got 7 wand charges. They could go for the kill. They've got Sonic Wave, maxed out screen, jump forward, Sonic Wave, and the burst damage overwhelms Hester Joe's minimal HP pool. And we are really being shown how to keep a Leshrac down in the laning phase.
How many deaths is that? 2 for him, Crystal Maiden also 2.
Mm-hmm.
And up at top lane, Lina stacking as much as he can, but the hookshot comes in.
Cogs push back. Ramsey still has a little bit more lightning. 16 health. He'll get potioned up, bottled up, has a soul ring in 5 seconds. If they go in too deep here, Danish Barrett could actually be getting themselves into some trouble.
Well, Ryze, no telekinesis there.
MCs will pop the Soul Ring now. Goes for Ryze. They sense this is going to be a free kill, especially with Remnant pushback into Remnant Telekinesis pullback into that one, easily getting the kill.
And now the Radiant are actually scouting out the stacks that are made. The two medium camps in the middle of the jungle. Oh, no.
Is this going to be a block off? Leshrac knows he's in trouble. Doesn't hit the split earth now. Blocked away by that Fisher. Heads to Joe, cleaned up by General, who's now on a killing spree.
Can they take the stacks now? Queen of Pain has three. Oh, she's got 4 points in Scream. I'm pretty sure they can go and steal those stacks. They know about the one that's sort of in the northern part of the middle of the jungle, but I'm not sure if they know the one that's close to the rune spot.
That would be so big. They took that away from the Leshrac. I think it's going to be Lina and Leshrac doing it together. Is this another kill? Pull back into the Remnant. This combination is so dangerous, and Clockwork will die once again. Use every bit of mana to escape, but the TPN from the Leshrac is not going to be effective.
What does Ace have? Oh, is it? Okay, he's got Aquila Drums, so indicative of the BOT's build, but now he's being harassed out.
Jumps away, fortunately, to the other side of the Fissure. State, State actually had his Soul Ring and Echo Slam ready to go, so if the PL ended up on the wrong side of the Fissure, I think he dies. So, lucky him.
Well, General's going towards an Orchid, so no Aghanim's build for him, but now Frostbitten up a middle lane. No follow through from the Leshrac, though. This Orchid, though, if you can get it, what, around 16, 17 minutes, which he's probably aiming for here as the game, you know, it's not going to progress as nicely as this, I don't think, anymore for Scary Faces, as Danish Bears will start setting themselves up to farm their jungle and play a lot more defensively, like Esterjo is right now. But once that Queen of Pain Orchid is up and running, PL, Leshrac, in fact, hell, any of these heroes from the Dire side are incredibly susceptible to just getting jumped and possibly solo killed.
Esterjo clears through one of the stacks, actually both of them, looks like. Didn't give the Lina any of the experience, which I'm a bit surprised. I thought they would put value on getting Lina to level 6, but it looks like they may still do that. Ryze is going to head down to the bottom lane to get that solo experience, while the Clockwork moves around and looks for kills. That counter ward just off the mark there, Shadow, hey? He goes into the counter ward range now and maybe spotted out.
She's still
Noya
dead, right?
Sees what's happening. They still have the hookshot, though, to be able to intercept some of this. Oh, but Jesus. Now the jump in. Managed to lock two inside the cogs. Maybe they can win this fight. General pops his Invis rune, and he's going to stay alive thanks to that. Ace is going to find the additional kill, looks like, on State.
Echo.
He has Echo Slam. Oh! Turns around. No, the doppelganger. Complete whiffed. Now the jump forward onto Hestjo. The invisible General pops out with a sonic wave. State still trying to get out. General Rocket will finish him off. Now he jumps out as Ace is looking for that Lance kill. Trying to catch up, but General's already healed himself enough that there's no way that Ace can actually pick him up. Rocket? Not enough.
But that's the defensive posture I was saying that Danish Bears would kind of, you know, turtle themselves into. They're farming the jungle, placing sentries to see the bounty hunter coming, and not showing themselves on lane. Whoa. Bounty? Okay, he's okay. He's fine. But if Scary Faces react like that, in force,
yeah,
and they get the better trade-off while Danish Bears are trying to play, you know, that's literally as defensively as you can go without sitting in your fountain. You're not showing on lanes, you're kind of saying, hey, look, we've got Lina on bot lane, you can go and kill her. That's a free kill for you. Uh-huh. Please don't touch our jungle. Please don't come and kill anyone else. And Scary Faces say, screw the Lina, we want to kill your Leshrac and your Clockwork, and maybe your Phantom Lancer if he gives up his own life as well. Things are looking rough.
At least they get Lina level 6 out of all this, so who knows, maybe we can have a quick pick-off on somebody. Earthshaker's farming pretty well. Tranquil Boots, Soul Ring. He hasn't gotten a single one of the last hits on the kills that he's gotten with the Bounty Hunter. So, considering that's all assist gold, his farm is quite nice. He's got to watch out, though, for the Clockwork. So I like the aggressive way he's playing with the Bounty Hunter, because if he plays too farmy and too solo, Clockwork's going to target him every single time because he's one of the very obvious heroes you can get a kill on.
Well, it swung the other way now. The Danish Bears have actually pushed down on this bottom lane with a hook shot up. And now with Laguna Blade available, they're actually looking for a kill. But Scary Faces, they're just playing this so perfectly. It's meticulous outplay. As every step of the way, every move that Danish Bears wants to try and pull off, it's the perfect counter movement out from SFZ.
Ooh, Ace. Got a long doppelganger jump away, and that scream will actually miss. Ooh, and the Lance misses as well. What was...
He's got no doppelganger for 2 seconds.
Oh,
time!
Oh, Ace, the shuriken comes in. They get yet another kill. Shadow A is going to be able to get his level 6 off the Crystal Maiden kill with Ramses coming in from behind. Claims it for them.
12-2.
Pretty rough. 13 minutes in, and Scary Faces are dominating this game so far with over a 5,000 gold lead. Bottom lane, hook shot in. Looks like they caught Eknard, but Eknard trying to get away from the Dragon Slave. Not going to make. Still, though, State is coming in. He has enough mana as soon as his Soul Ring comes up, or maybe some tick mana. Ryze certainly is not getting away from this one. Waits out for the Fissure in order to try and TP away, I thought, but
no,
that's not going to happen.
You know what compounds the issue as well for the Dire?
Ramses? All right, that was awkward. They just ran into each other.
You know what compounds the issue as well for the Dire?
What's that?
I wish there was a way to find out how much gold they've spent on sentries and TPs and, you know, wards and things like that. Because it feels they've thrown down more than enough sentries to keep tabs on a bounty hunter. Mm-hmm. But the reward they've got from that expenditure has not really paid off at all. They haven't given themselves safe farming. They haven't really done anything with it. And this Crystal Maiden is paying. She's sitting at level 4. She's tracked up by the bounty hunter, and she's running around with brown boots and observer wards 14 minutes into this game.
How early did they pick the Crystal Maiden? It wasn't in the first
pick.
One. Yeah, that was not a good choice.
Fifth and final pick, yeah.
Against a bounty hunter? I don't know.
See, in my mind, the Lina plus bounty works well, but if it's a pair, if you use them together.
Right.
Oh, they've got the bounty. Okay.
Yeah. I mean, well, I guess...
Like, Frostbite LSA, if you've got sentries there, you stop the bounty hunter. Like, you've got to react to his movements, though. But you split them up. Lina was top, CM was mid. You didn't have that pairing of the abilities.
Noya is going to go down once again. The telekinesis on to Miguel. They're going to be able to catch him as well. He doesn't even have hookshot to be able to get out. State, Echo Slam to finish him off. He will be hit by the double stun. Nice play there from Hestajoe. Ramsey's actually low on mana. He's just going to try and TP out. No! The LSA stops it. And that was big. Danish Bears pick up two very important kills.
The Lina gets 1,000 gold. She can almost afford a Yule Scepter.
The lead is
up to 2,100.
Now he's going to be picked off before he can actually buy some of these items. Shuriken bounced off the creep. Nicely played by Shadow A. General Smoke, hasted, has an Orchid, looking to shut down the Phantom Lancer. The Bounty Hunter's going to scout it out for him.
Oh, that's a track kill.
It most certainly is. The Sonic Wave and a Shuriken. They make short work of the Phantom Lancer. 17-6 now, 16 minutes in. And as soon as Danish Bears respond with some sort of a successful engagement, SFZ shout right back with a couple of kills. Blink Dagger soon on our Earthshaker.
So Danish Bears has Phantom Lancer and Leshrac and Lina. Arguably three of the strongest heroes this patch, right?
Yep.
Scary Faces are doing everything right against it, though. Their laning phase has been particularly good, and this Bounty Hunter has paid off massively. The Bounty, I'm starting to wonder, or I've been wondering for quite some time, seeing Tier 2 teams like insta-ban out with Phantom Lancer, just saying, we don't want to handle this, it's always going to be a really sticky hero that's difficult to work around. And I think that's the biggest thing. He makes you play a completely different game. Danish Bears here, they've tried to play the stock standard Phantom Lancer, the really, you know, set in stone Leshrac. Everything's been really straightforward. They've drafted decently, I feel. They've, you know, done the full meta draft. But Scary Faces, the Bounty Hunter, has been in this position where Danish Bears haven't reacted to it. It feels like they haven't adjusted their gameplay to deal with it.
Yeah, as soon as they lost their counterword mid, they never, like, responded with another counterword, you know? And that was, I think, a big fault of theirs. General goes up to the top lane to slow down this push. And there is the Earthshaker Blink Dagger. So he's going to head back to base, gets enough gold out of the jungle to be able to buy a TP scroll as well. Let's see where he heads off to. Shadow A is going to be able to scout out the clockwork and might see the Lina as well. But they want another track kill. They're going to start with Storm Spirit, gets sucked inside of the cogs and manages to get enough damage to easily kill him. Ace comes in from the side. Nice Light Strike Array out for Mechnar, slowing things down, but he will still die. He's just trying to buy space for the rest of his allies to cleanly get out.
General's coming in from the west, though, and they know someone's here. The Light Strike makes the right decision and goes north instead. Shadow Ray looking for the track onto him.
Showed himself in lane. That's going to be the Blink Dagger revealed. I thought he was just going to hide it out and try and go for the surprise three-man Echo Slam or something, but
Dire's middle tower is under attack. Bounty, honestly. Four-roll Bounty Hunter with Arcane's mech. 18 minutes into the game and 500 gold left over.
Yeah, the fact that you're able, because you're Bounty Hunter, you're able to be a part of every track kill because you're the one who put it out there in the first place, means that you're able to go over an offlaner's farm like half the time. Echo Slam straight up, Shuriken and Fisher.
Even the track as
what
well.
What a combination, and you're right, another track kill for the two of them.
Crazy, crazy stuff. And Shadow Ray goes from having 500 gold to having nearly 1,000 gold. Ready to spend on his next item. You know, probably the Greaves finish them off. It's always going to be really, really great for you to have them. Can you?
He's being shadowed, literally shadowed by smoked up sisters.
Oh.
And now they're going to reveal Shadow Ape, but the question is, are they going to be able to do anything? A two-man Fissure, Sonic Wave over the top, all supports disappear, and Shadow Ape actually managed to get away. Now that stun misses, Hester Joe is forced to TP out, but State says no. He's going to be able to jump in and Chan Totem stop that one and gets the additional kill plus another track on top of everything else. 22-7 now.
Okay, and then the tower goes down. So Bounty Hunter, 1 minute and 20 seconds ago, had 470 gold. He's now got 2,000.
Yeah, he could go the Blink Dagger, he could go the Guardian Greaves.
Oh, buddy.
It's pretty disgusting.
I don't know what you can do to stop this, honestly. Your Leshrac has bought a Bracer to try and tank up that little bit more. I thought maybe a Glimmercate, but still wants that Bloodstone with the point booster picked up. Your Lina nearly has the Yule Scepter done, but Clockwork, Blademail, still 700 gold away. And the PL, his late game prowess, not understating it, not underselling Ace and his ability to fight through this, but with Ramses jumping onto him while he's farming by his tier 2. That just shows how much pressure and how wary they are of this aggressive jump power from Scary Faces.
They're going to go a secondary Orchid. Storm Spirit's pretty common at this point in time. Bloodstone Orchid. So that's going to be a secondary lockdown against the PL, as well as the Leshrac. I think, you know what, like, forget about giving up the Leshrac and going, like, the four-position silencer. This is a much better way, I think, to be able... Like, the four-position silencer I've not been impressed with at all from teams. I think this is a much more solid way. Just run double intelligence cores and jump on him. Oh! Miguel's going to be able to catch out. State here starts trying to bang through that cask and will be able to get away. Greaves. The Garden Greaves keeps him alive. Now he turns around. Fisher, Miguel is definitely going down here. Egnard's going to be the next target, though. Managed to get off the Fate Bolt before he dies. There goes the Clockwork. SFZ still waiting on the next response. They have a double damage Shuriken. Oh, Hester Joe just gets torn apart. Noya falls as well.
The DD Quap.
As soon as Danish Bears think they might be able to win a fight, they surge forward and immediately get caught. And State is actually going to look for an extra kill. They know where this Phantom Lancer is going. State catches up. Fisher lands on him and actually goes for the wrong one. That is the fake, my friend. 50-50 shot. And, well, still, great fight nonetheless for SFZ. 25-8. I would say about 15 to 18 of those were track kills.
A whole bunch of them. General is 10.05. Orchid Ags, 1,600 gold. And Danish Bears, I think at this point, you know, you're still in the game. You're still thinking about this Phantom Lancer can bring you back, can carry you through. But you've got to start wondering about game number two. Got to start thinking about draft-wise. Bounty Hunter, up at the top of that ban phase.
Cog's pushback, no! Telekinesis stops him before he can do anything, and an Echo Slam comes in and shows Danish Bears what's up. Ace now going to be able to doppelganger to the side, heads to Joe. Nice stun up, but SFZ don't really care. Tier 3s, Tier 4s, it just doesn't matter. They'll keep on running through your base to claim the kill. Shot after shot goes after the Storm Spirit, but will not be able to get the kill. Looks like Shadow A will die. No, Guardian Grease.
Of course.
He'll stay alive as well. SFZ. I mean, if that just doesn't demoralize your opponents, I don't know what will. You got dove under your Tier 4 tower and weren't able to get a turnaround kill. Not even a support.
And now 15 Bloodstone charges on the Stolen with an Orchid being picked up. The point I was making before that fight kicked off, I don't know. I don't know if it stands anymore. I don't know if you can really look at this Phantom Lancer and think, yeah, the PL with the Lash Rack can carry us through this game.
It's just not possible without Diffusal. Like, when the Diffusal is, it's not even that late.
Yeah, it's pretty late.
All things considered, let's put it that way. All things considered, when the score is 29-8,
okay,
it's not that late, right?
I'll give you that.
All right, thank you, Durka. But like, you've got double Orchids on the battlefield.
Yeah.
Like, you have to have that purge. You have to.
The Invisible Bounty Hunter now with a Blink Dagger, so he can freely just run around, track people, blink out. He'll be fine.
The Ratman.
That Yule Scepter? Bets? Yule Scepter. Ever complete on Lina in this game?
Still not got it. Oh, damn.
Miguel. Nice dodge on the Light Strike Array. Three-man Fisher to the side. Shuriken bounce. Will jump around. And now, whoa!
Hello?
Egnart. I didn't realize that one, but he stole Hookshot. He'll grab Hookshot. And be able to finish him off 33-8 now. The score just keeps on ramping up, and so too does Storm Spirit's Bloodstone charges.
What's he up to now, 20?
17.
Yeah. He should be at 20 by now.
So again, Lina, the bet is, does he ever complete Yule Scepter?
No.
No? Think SFZ are going to be able to end this game first?
I mean, unless it's on the floor, on the courier, or, you know, hiding somewhere.
I mean, you have to think about it this way. If he gets one kill, that probably gets him enough reliable golds that he has Yule Scepter Recipe. Question is he going to get that one kill with a level 1 Laguna Blade?
Yeah, he's halfway to level 11.
Noya, maybe this is a start. Ramsey's pretty far forward. No.
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 No. No. Lashrak's alive in 3 seconds, but it's last chance saloon here for Danish Bears. Racks have fallen. And Scary Faces, do they go for more?
Yeah, come on, Ryze, you can do this. I believe in you. Get me that Yule Scepter. Start Laguna Blading creeps. I don't care. Get some gold.
Why? Why would you Laguna Blade a creep?
I mean, 34 gold. Every 60 seconds, every 70 seconds, excuse me, it's only level 1. Every 70 seconds.
One guaranteed creep.
Guarantee 34 gold.
Is it a guaranteed creep? The melee creeps have 580 HP. You have to use
all... Okay.
You have to use it on the ranged one.
All right. Range creep. Guaranteed 30 gold.
Oh, God. You can't even one hit a creep. Oh, Lina.
Is this Octarine Core on Queen of Pain? Or is this another Bloodstone? It's just like, whatever. We're getting so many kills. Let's just Bloodstone our way into this game. I mean, it's not bad. When you're so far ahead and you have that pocket suicide. It's pretty... Oh, no. It is Octarine. So, 30-second Sonic Wave.
And this smoke out from Danish Bears has done nothing at all. They moved out, baiting the Phantom Lancer at top, but take a look at Scary Faces all down towards the bottom lane. Ramsey's on the Storm, scouting, but he's not going to pop the smoke there. Gets close.
How much is the Yule? 650?
Shut up, Cap.
650, he's getting there. 200 gold! Show Storm. Me Yule Scepter!
Storm is going to insta-kill him.
He probably will. Blade Mail on the clockwork. They're waiting for their time. They've got an invisible Storm Spirit jumping in. Ryze! No!
Told you.
No! 300 gold down the drain. SFZ. Having fun and all, but they still need to actually go on the objective, the tier 3 tower. Or maybe they go back for Roshan? I don't know. Clockwork waiting for his time to initiate. He's got the blade mail. He can jump the Earthshaker. They're going to grab Ace here. Does have the purge, but oh my god! The burst damage still overwhelms, and there's the Echo Slam to finish him off. A Fissure over the top. Shadow is even able to get away. Oh, no, he's not. Miguel actually turning things around slightly. Managed to get one kill, almost a second in the Storm Spirit, but beyond godlike speed for General.
Lesh and Clock have buyback here, but without your Phantom Lance, without the
level 2 Laguna Blade, just run in there and ult somebody.
You can do it.
No!
Come on, Ryze. Come on. Your last. Like your last dying
lost.
Just walk in there and do it.
No, Ryze is AFK. He's done with this game. All right, well, that ends game number one. Pretty dominant display there from the Scary Faces.
Do you think there was. Was it a drafting win from Scary Faces?
I was literally just going to bring this up and ask you the same question, and my answer to myself would be it's not an error in draft. It's just that Scary Faces outmaneuvered completely.
Yeah, I think it was a total outplay.
There was not a single misstep from them, honestly.
I mean, the fact that they never returned with a counter ward in the middle lane and just left Leshrac, you know, like, you lose your counter ward and you're just like, well, that sucks, like, bro. I got to go jungle.
Exactly.
You know?
Crystal Maiden went to that large camp, placed a sentry ward to the west of the large camp to see if Bounty Hunter was ganking her, and then left the Leshrac to his own devices in the middle lane. You know, what can you do?
I don't think you could do that to a Leshrac. It's not nice. So, we're going to take a break on our last game of the night, game number 2 between SFZ and the Danish Bears will be coming up.